This here in front of me is the Ubox. Or is it pronounced Ubox? I like Ubox. Chuwi has sent this to me for review. They're not paying me to do so, but I do get to keep the unit, so I will be very enthusiastic about it, just so you know. Let's find out just how awesome it is after the intro. So you wanna see me Ubox it? It comes in this simple but elegant brown box with specifications at the bottom. The variant they sent me has 16 GB of RAM and a 512 GB SSD, as you can see here. After opening the cover, we're greeted with an envelope with some vapor. Ah, there's our new friend. So at the front of the Ubox, we find a power button, a headphone jack, a USB-C port that is supposedly USB 4.0, and two USB-A ports that should be USB 3.2. Not too shabby. At the back, we see another two USB-A ports, one USB 2.0 and one USB 3.2. A DisplayPort port that's described as being version 1.2. But jumping a bit ahead, I can already tell you it's capable of driving my 240Hz 4040p monitor just fine. So it's probably 1.4. There's an HDMI 2.0 port. I can test if that might be higher, but since they claim it can drive a 4K screen at 120Hz, I think this should be 2.1. There's two 2.5 gigabit Ethernet ports and the barrel jack hole for power. At the left side there's, well, a cool looking stripe. And at the right side we have some sticker tuning and a Kensington lock slot thingy. In this small box we find a phaser mounting bracket that aligns with the screw holes at the bottom of the unit. You could use this to mount the unit at the back of a monitor or TV screen, out of sight. And of course an external power supply. You want specs? Here they are. This unit has a Ryzen 5 6600H APU with Radeon 660M graphics. 16 GB of DDR5 RAM, of which 3 go to the GPU by default, but that amount is configurable in the system's BIOS. It has a 512 GB Gen 3 SSD and Wi-Fi 6 and Bluetooth 5.2. Upgrading this Ubox is very easy. You can just lift the top cover like this. Get these two clips out of the way. And the metal plate that covers the RAM and SSD should just come off by pulling this thing. Or not. Well, good enough. There's a thermal pad for the Ryzen branded NVMe drive and a spare one to use on a second drive if you wish to upgrade storage. Pretty cool that they include this. Only a single DDR5 module. That's, well, I believe it's not that bad on DDR5, but still. It would have been nice to see an actual dual channel setup here. I guess there's room to upgrade performance a bit. There's an upgradable Wi-Fi and Bluetooth module under the NVMe drive. There even is an unpopulated fan port, so you can upgrade cooling as well if you feel you need to. Putting it back together is as simple as opening it up. Even though it's easy to get off, the cover holds pretty well. Maybe don't try this at home, kids. Let's connect it, see what we've got. Hello? Is my screen turned off? Oh, it's alive! Let's just set it up real quick. You can't see this very well, can you? Let me adjust my camera. Let's move to capturing the HDMI output. Looks like a clean Windows 11 install without much bloatware installed. Sure, there's the AMD Settings application and Minecraft Education Edition, but overall not much that wouldn't be here after a clean install, I think. Nothing from Chuwi itself, for instance. Let's check that AMD Settings app. Interestingly, that shows itself in Dutch, even though the system's language is English. Probably looks at regional settings instead, I don't know. Okay, we have some performance profiles. No games? What about Minecraft then? You know what, let's try to run that one. Sign in. Do I have to? Ah. Why is this included? When most people buying this probably don't even have a school account. The Uboxes fan is audible for sure, even when idle. Chuwi asked me if I could compare it with a Lockbox X, which I cannot do directly because it's not mine, so I don't have it around anymore. But I do remember the Lockbox X being extremely silent. This Ubox is not loud by any means, and it's not a high-pitched whine either. But I guess I'd want to turn this one off before recording a voiceover, just to be sure. The power profiles don't seem to make any difference in that area. Let's run a few benchmarks before installing Linux. About 1213 FPS in Furmark, 14,627 points in Geekbench's GPU test, a single core score of 1963 and a multi-core score of 7592 in Geekbench's CPU test. Chuwi claims that there's a Gen 3 NVMe drive in this system, and Crystal Dispark seems to agree with that statement. Editing a basic video at 1080p in resolve is no issue at all, without any tweaks. And rendering that video to H.264 happens at 160-ish frames per second. That's some pretty decent performance. Alright, let's try Linux. Who cares about Windows, right? Plug in my Ventoy stick and press F7 to open the boot menu. Let's pick Open Mandriva. I'll skip ahead to the installed system. Everything seems to work fine. Wi-Fi and Bluetooth work. Both the analog audio output and audio through HDMI are functional. Interestingly, the unit seems more silent in Linux. Power draw in Linux is also a bit lower, around 7 watts idle against 9 in Windows. So I guess it's generating a little less heat in Linux. That's kinda cool, pun not intended. But doing just about anything makes the fan turn on and the silence is gone again. There's no fan control in the system's BIOS, so maybe LACT can help us out? No. To be fair, I think this only controls the GPU fan, so yeah. Sensors detect doesn't see any sensors. So tough luck if you want to change the fan curve, I guess. Please, Chuwi, provide an update to fix this in the system's BIOS. I mean, it's not horrible, but still, I would like the fan to start at a little lower speed, I guess. Here's me trying to record what the fan sounds like at just a little load. And at high load. Do note that this is a very sensitive microphone set at the highest possible input level. If I get this close to that mic on that setting, you're going to hear me breathe. No matter how silent I try to be, it's definitely not that bad. About power draw, by the way, it uses around 60 watts in a demanding game. That's about the highest I have seen. Next, I tried installing Steam and just running some games. And I was not impressed, to be honest. So I ran Furmark to see what the difference with Windows would be. Ouch, that's about 2/3 of the frames per second compared to Windows 11. I restored Windows and confirmed that games are running some 10 to 30% faster in there. That's not what I expected. So I installed Arch to rule out it would be an Open Mandriva issue. Nah. No difference between X11 and Wayland either. I tried several options, like setting the power profile in KDE and LACT, but it didn't have any impact. A game mode and Ryzen adjust I forgot to capture, but both didn't have any impact either. So I figured I'd try AMD's Pro Driver this time. And now? Performance in American Truck Simulator suddenly doubled, even quite a bit higher than it was in Windows. Furmark now runs at about the same speed as it did in Windows. Eureka! Oh, well, it doesn't work for Vulkan games. And yes, I ran those through VK Pro, but to no avail. I also tried Bazite, which I apparently didn't capture, since that distribution is more gaming focused, but to no avail. I wondered if it's just the GPU or is the CPU affected as well. So I ran Geekbench and ouch. That single core speed is a little lower, but the multi-core score is about half of what it was in Windows. I figured I'd try the Xeon-1 variant of OpenMandriva, which is compiled specifically for modern AMD CPUs. Right on! Both the single and multi-core score higher than in Windows this time. So I guess if you need raw CPU power, using a kernel compiled with Xeon-1 is a good idea. Note that OpenMandriva has a server edition that's compiled that way as well. Just saying. Gaming performance did not improve in this edition though. So instead of showing you just how it performs in Windows or Linux, I'll show you the same set of games with the exact same settings on both, and most of them in 1080p. On Windows, American Truck Simulator runs a bit over 70fps in general. Damn, that's a sturdy poll! On Linux, we've seen that it runs at around 45-50fps. But it can run at around 85-90fps when running it through ProGL. In Windows, Doom Eternal runs around 45-50, sometimes even 60fps. On Linux, I get around 30-45 most of the time. By the way, this machine does support ray tracing both on Windows and Linux. But well, on Windows this is what the game looks like without it. Let's enable it. And this is with ray tracing enabled. Performance gets a lot worse and well, maybe I should follow a class in recognizing ray tracing because I don't see it. In Windows, FPS Chess runs at around 27-30fps. Linux doesn't even get to half of that. In Ryte 4, I have to set the resolution scale to 50% to make it playable in Windows, which provided me a decent 55-ish fps. Yeah, I'm still bad at it. With the exact same settings, I'm getting some 30-40fps in Linux. Using the Steam Deck preset, I'm getting around 20-30fps in Turbo Overkill on Windows. And on Linux, it's having a hard time even reaching 15fps. Oof. Shadow of the Tomb Raider I ran explicitly because of its ray tracing support. On Windows, I get around 25fps without it in this spot. Turning on ray tracing at medium, it's not a huge impact, but I still don't see the difference. Setting it too high does have a bit more impact on performance, but yeah, well. Anyway, on Linux, on that same spot, without ray tracing enabled, performance is actually pretty close to Windows. Harbinger on Windows sits in the high 20s to low 30s. While on Linux we're staying in the low 20s and even dropping below 20fps. I doubt someone who buys this device will be a diehard gamer, but to get the most gaming performance, it kinda saddens me to say that you should stick with Windows on this unit. So how about retro emulation? These small boxes are perfect for that, right? I would usually go for better Sierra, but since that's based on Arch Linux, we can expect this to perform about the same as a basic Arch install. So I downloaded Retrobed for Windows and just tried a single game on a bunch of systems and will compare those to running them on better Sierra. Retrobed somehow would not start when connected to my capture unit, so I connected it to our living room TV and filmed that screen. I'm not looking at FPS this time, just if it runs well, since most games are running at a limited frame rate anyway because of the emulated systems. GameCube, Mario Kart Double Dash in particular, runs very well on Retrobed, rendered at 1080p resolution. It's perfectly fine on better Sierra as well. Mario Kart Wii runs great on Retrobed, rendered at 1080p. It doesn't perform great on better Sierra though, but at 720p it's fine. Mario Kart 8 for Wii U runs great at 1080p on Retrobat and runs great at Bethesda at 1080p as well. Crazy Taxi 2 for Dreamcast runs great at 1080p on Retrobat and runs great on Bethesda as well. Disney Pixar Cars for PS2 runs decent at 1080p on Retrobat and pretty similar, maybe even a little better, on Bethesda. On PSP, Outrun 2006 Coast to Coast is pretty awesome at 1080p on Retrobat and just as awesome on Bethesda. Shout out to HumbleMod, by the way, for speaking about this game on Blue Sky. I didn't know of its existence before that. I somehow couldn't run PS3 games on Retrobat, so here's Need for Speed Carbon on Bethesda only, running quite decently. I guess it could be tweaked a bit, but this is the out-of-the-box experience. On Xbox, I tried MotoGP Ultimate Racing Technology 3, which I had to set to 720p to make it playable at all. On Bethesda it's a bit worse. Xbox 360 is not great on Retrobat. It seems like it's missing some lighting or something. This happens both in Fable 3 and Motorcycle Club. On Bethesda it's exactly the same, although the frame rate seems lower, but it's hard to tell when you can't see anything. One last thing I'd like to point out about this machine is that it supports HDMI CEC. This can be enabled in the system's BIOS like this, and can be used to send and receive control signals over HDMI. Using this, you could for instance use your TV's remote to control a media center system on the Ubox. I haven't been able to get that working though. It does turn off the TV when the Ubox turns off, and similarly, the Ubox turns on when I turn the TV on, so it seems to be working on a hardware level. Controlling Kodi using the TV remote though, nope. I will probably keep this unit in our living room, so if I find a solution for that, I will be sure to let you guys know about it. If there's anything you'd like to know about the Ubox, let me know in the comments below. There's a link in the description to check it out for yourself. You can use the code EXITGUYUBOX to get a discount. I don't know how much, they forgot to tell me. I guess that's all I have for you today. I hope you liked this video. Thank you very much for watching. Until next time.